This material is intended for general informational purposes only and does not constitute legal advice. The law varies by jurisdiction and is constantly changing. For legal advice, you should consult a lawyer that can apply the appropriate law to the facts in your case.
Aloha, I'm Coralie Chun Matayoshi, and welcome to my legal podcast, What's the Law? Each week, you will learn valuable information about various legal topics to help you get through life's ups and downs, and even when things go sideways. Now with me is Alexander Silvert. He's a former state and federal public defender with decades of trial experience. When Catherine Kealoha accused her uncle Gerard Puana of stealing their mailbox, Ali led a painstaking seven-year-long effort to unearth evidence of a conspiracy to frame Puana and bring the case to federal authorities. Ali just came out with a book called The Mailbox Conspiracy, and in the next few podcasts, he will be giving us an inside look at the greatest corruption case in Hawaii's history. Welcome, Ali.
Hello, good afternoon.
The Sixth Amendment of the Constitution gives criminal defendants facing over 6 months of imprisonment the right to a speedy and public trial by an impartial jury of their peers. After going through dozens of jury trials, Ali, you know your way around the courtroom and a thing or two about juries. What can you tell us about jury strategies and for selecting and interacting with juries?
Well, what you have to remember about juries and is that a jury is made up of 12 people and two alternates. There are 26 eyes that are all around the courtroom.
Yeah.
And they're not necessarily looking at the witness or the judge. They could be looking at a defendant and seeing how the defendant's body reaction to a witness's testimony is. They could be looking at how the defendant and I all of a sudden glance at each other when a witness makes an incriminating statement against us. So they're looking at a lot of different things. And when you pick a jury of voir dire, when you actually pick those 12 members of the jury plus the two alternates, there's actually 90 jurors in the courtroom. And this is before the trial even starts. And you don't know who of those 90 jurors are going to be picked. And so from the moment they walk in the room and you're going to pick a jury, you got to be very cognizant of what you're doing, how you're dressed, how you're acting, how you appear, and what you do. You know, if a judge reads an indictment and the defendant laughs or smiles too much.
Right.
I mean, what is a jury, what is any person going to really think about that?
Right.
So in strategizing in terms of a jury, you know, of course, we always talk to a defendant and tell them what they should wear, how they should look, how they should act, how we're going to act together. I try to look good. I try to play the part of a lawyer, you know, very concerned and so forth. The government's doing the same thing. You know, their agents look very spiffy. They're wearing suits and American flags on their jacket. So, you know, everybody is very cognizant and aware of that jurors are looking at them, because you got to understand something. A judge isn't going to make this decision. It's those juries.
Right.
So ultimately, it's the perception of those juries that matter. And everybody's trying to get the jury to look at them more favorably than otherwise, or at least in my case with criminal defendants, not to be scared of them. I mean, I want them to walk away thinking this is somebody's son or daughter. This is somebody's auntie or uncle. You know, they have children. I want them to not be afraid of them, even though they're charged with a crime. Because if they're afraid of them, that's just going to make them listen to evidence and want to interpret evidence in a particular way.
Right.
So in jury voir dire, where you pick a jury, which is a very complicated process. There are TV shows made about this. There's a show on TV now, Bull, where he's an expert on picking juries. So, but that's, you know, really doesn't happen in the courtroom very often, especially with a public defender. We don't have money to hire a jury expert. We're doing it from our gut and from our years of experience. So when you're picking a jury, what happens is you get these 90 people who come in, you know very little about them. And what you're doing is you can strike jurors for cause, which means, you know, if a juror's sick or too elderly and can't hear the evidence very well, or really has some family issues or health issues that make it impossible for them to really concentrate, you can strike them for cause. That's fine. But then every side has what are called peremptory strikes. And really, that's just a fancy word, meaning I can strike people for any reason I want, as long as I'm not violating the Constitution. I can't do it because they're a woman or a man, or because they're black or white, but I can do it for any reason I want. You know, if I see a jury looking at us and scowling, you know, they're, you know, I can say I'm getting rid of that juror. So I have 10 strikes, the government has six. And essentially what happens during this process is you're not picking the people you want on the jury. You're eliminating the people you don't want on the jury. And that's kind of, and in the end, how a jury is picked. Both sides are really kind of eliminating jurors they don't think are going to be favorable to them.
Right. So sometimes you exercise your peremptory challenge, but then you might get somebody worse. So you're really taking a gamble and have to look at the whole thing. Like, how bad do I not want this person, right?
Absolutely. You're always looking down the line. You have a chart with all the jurors and you're saying, well, if I get rid of this person, well, then juror number 15 comes in and I like that person less or no, or so forth. So it's a little bit of a game, but it's a critical thing. But part of the process is what's called voir dire. And so when you have these 90 people sitting in the courtroom, they're going to be asked a lot of questions before you have to pick. And this is where there's a big difference between state practice and federal practice in Hawaii. In state practice, the lawyers are the ones who ask these prospective jurors questions. And that can go on for a while. In the O.J. Simpson case, it went on for weeks. And you can really find out a lot if you're asking the question as a lawyer. Mm-hmm. But in federal court, it's the judge who asks the question, not the lawyer. I only get 15 minutes at the end of all of the judge questions. And the questions from the court are more of a yes or no type question. Mm-hmm. So for example, does anyone here have a friend or relative who's a member of law enforcement? And people raise their hand. And then the judge would say, due to that relationship, would that relationship impair your ability to be fair or neutral to both parties in this case? If anybody thinks it would impair their ability, please raise their hand. And then of course, most people don't raise their hand or right. do it. And then that's it. They're considered to be good jurors. Now, as a defense attorney, I want to know a lot more. You know, who is this person? Is this your husband or your wife? Is this a close family relative? Do you like them? Do you not like them? Do you go to dinner with them? Do you socialize? I want to know a lot more about that relationship. But I'm only given 15 minutes at the end of the day to ask questions. So I really don't have the ability, and neither does the government from their point, to get into the nitty-gritty with any juror. So when it's our turn to talk to them, we have to have a different strategy of what we're trying to do because we have such limited time.
So what kind of people are the defense looking for?
So obviously, you know, every case is a little bit different depending upon the nature of the charge or who the witnesses might be. But in the Puana case, all of the government witnesses were going to be law enforcement. They were going to be the Louis, the chief of police, his prosecutor wife, and a bunch of police officers from HPD. So we were obviously looking, we didn't want people who were favorable to law enforcement. We wanted independent thinkers because in a trial like this, where the government has to prove or convince 12 jurors unanimously that someone's guilty beyond a reasonable doubt, I just need one to say no. And while it would be nice to have 12 to say no and get a not guilty, at worst, I need one to say, I don't believe this person is guilty. And so we're always looking for that independent thinker, the strong person who's going to hold out. Because if there are 11 jurors who think the person's guilty and you're the one saying no, at some point you're going to succumb to the pressure of the other 11. And we're trying to pick the person who won't happen to. So that was one of the goals.
And you're also trying to pick someone because this was a complicated case that just doesn't want to hurry up and do a verdict and go home. You want somebody that's going to really listen and try to understand because this was a complex case.
Absolutely. We needed, you know, we didn't want anybody who would have to go home to a business or to take care of an elderly parent. So those were also things we were looking at. And so during this process, of course, since I only have 15 minutes, I'm trying to get as much information I can about them being fair and understanding that you can't believe a law enforcement officer more than any other witness. So I'm talking about those concepts in general, but I'm also trying to get them to like me because this, you know, at jury selection is when you begin to show your personality and try to win the jury over. So in this particular case, one of the things I did was I look a lot like former Governor Abercrombie. I used to walk down in the federal courthouse and there would be, you know, immigration day where new people were being sworn in they would see me across the courtyard and with Governor Abercrombie, and they all bow or wave their hand. And I had long ago given up, you know, waving my, you know, saying, no, I'm not the governor. You
just
know,
wave. Just let them think it. You
know, look, if they want to believe they saw Governor Abercrombie makes their day, who am I to rain on that parade? But in the courtroom, so I use that to my advantage. So, you know, the courtroom's very serious. The judge has been talking to them for hours. You know, the prosecutor did their voir dire, very serious and stern. This is a serious case. And I get up and I say, well, I know we've had, you know, this is all serious and we've had a long day, but how many of you, when you came into this courtroom today, looked over at me and said, why is Governor Abercrombie in court today? And everybody kind of chuckled and I raised my hand and then half the courtroom raised their hand and we all laughed and the tension was released. And it was nice. I mean, if you can get people laughing with you and not at you, that's always a good thing. So right. It was that kind of thing that happened during jury selection. And I did it one more time when I asked jurors if they would believe a lawyer more than any other witness, because we had Catherine and Kealoha. And, you know, my response would be, and my thought process was, of course, no one's going to believe a lawyer more than anybody else. How many lawyer jokes have we heard? And Jerp raised a hand and said, yes, Catherine Kealoha would be believable because as a lawyer, she had a higher standard to tell the truth, which is absolutely correct, but couldn't be further from the reality of what was happening. And so we had a nice interchange there, which educated all the other jurors that, you know, that wasn't to be the case. And of course I did excuse that juror, but it was that kind of process that by the time the jury is actually, you get your 12 in the box, so to speak, you kind of know them a little bit and they know you a little bit. Mm-hmm. And if that's all you can get out of jury selection, that's what we wanted. And I think we accomplished that. So we were very comfortable with the jury that got sworn in that day.
Mm-hmm. I feel like there's a little bit of a double standard for women, because remember in the O.J. Simpson case, everybody was talking about Marsha Clark's hair. And when we used to go to court, it used to be very conservative, not prudish, but no plunging necklines. I think we had to wear stocking, you know, hosiery, and no stilettos and all of that, because people are really looking at you and they are wondering what your motivation is, and you need to be believable, right?
Absolutely. I have a funny story about that. My wife, who's a former state court judge, did a jury trial in state court. And then at the end of the case, after the jury had rendered its verdict, it's usual for a judge to bring the jury in and kind of thank them for service. And all the jury wanted to know was, what year did she win the Miss Hawaii contest? You know, which of course she had not, but that's what they were thinking the whole time.
The whole time.
You know, so you never know what a jury is focusing on. You hope as a defense attorney and a prosecutor, they're hoping they're focusing on the case. Right. Sometimes as a defense attorney, not so much, but you know, that, you can't control a jury. And what, as I said, they're looking at different things. They come from different backgrounds. They have different perceptions, different history. And you're just hoping that you can play on all of that to make them understand your side of the case.
And that's a wrap. We want to thank Ali Silbert for his time and expertise. And thank you for joining us on What's the Law. Until next time, ahui ho.